Angel is brought to you by Audible, with an unmatched selection of audiobooks, original audio shows, news, comedy, and more. Get a free audiobook with a 30-day trial at audible.com/angelbook.
Hey, everybody, it's Jason Calacanis. Welcome to my new podcast, Angel. Yes, this is a podcast just about angel investing. Obviously, some of you have been listening to This Week in Startups for the past 8 years. We've done over 700 episodes, and that podcast is about startups and also includes investors and journalists and pundits and authors, the whole gamut. We're doing 100 episodes of This Week in Startups a year, but we decided, based upon the success of the book Angel, to do a complimentary podcast about only angel investing, since there seems to be a lot of people out there who are reading the book and who want to know how to be an angel investor, how to partner with other angels, and learn the best practices. We thought we'd start a podcast dedicated just to angel investing. This is, I think, the third or maybe the fourth episode, and we've had some great guests already. Today will be no different. If you want to subscribe to the podcast, go to angelpodcast.com, angelpodcast.com. And thanks so much to my friends at Audible for sponsoring season one of Angel. If you haven't read the book, Angel, you can go to Audible and download it. We have some proprietary interviews there, some unique content available only on Audible. And today on the program, again, you can also search iTunes and Spotify for Angel the Podcast. It should be showing up there shortly, but angelpodcast.com. And you can follow me on Twitter. I'm at Jason. Okay, so the book's been doing great, and I have great respect for the next founder turned angel investor, because he does the work. He works really hard for his founders. The founders who I send to him always come back from meetings, and I've never told him this, but feeling a sense of enthusiasm and that they've been heard and that you're a smart cat. So with that, I will welcome Zach Coelius. Coelius. I got it right. Coelius.
Excellent.
We've known each other for years.
A decade, it feels like.
A decade.
Yeah.
You were an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
Did several companies. You did okay as an entrepreneur. Singles and doubles.
Didn't fully suck. Wasn't a home run hitter, but, you know, I lasted. I was good at lasting. Yeah. Last one did a decade long, so yeah. I had survivability, which is important for entrepreneurs.
Right, not giving up. And then somewhere, I think probably caused by Naval and AngelList, you got the angel investing bug, or did it predate AngelList? Because I remember you used to send an email around called Deal Flow.
Yep.
I don't know when you started sending the Deal Flow email, but was that 6 years ago?
Yeah,
five,
something
six?
Like that, yeah.
Right when I was starting Open Angel Forum, in fact. Mm-hmm. And back then, nobody knew who the angels were.
Yeah.
And nobody knew how to get in touch with them.
Yeah.
It was a completely different market. So why did you start that Deal Flow email pre the existence of even syndicates at the time were not a thing?
Yeah. I mean, the simplest reason is I love the entrepreneurial process. Love it, love it, love it, love it, love it, love it. And the best part is when it's somebody else doing the work. So you're like, you sit down with somebody and they tell you your idea, and you get to like engage with them and have ideas with them and brainstorm with them. And then they go home and get punched in the face every day and do the hard work of being an entrepreneur, and you just get to have fun ideas. So that's like, and I've always enjoyed that. Like, it's fun to help them out, be useful, make introductions, generally try to like add some value to somebody who's doing, you know, doing the hard part of being about an entrepreneur. And it's, I just have this empathy for people who do that, that just like it moves my soul. It gets me really excited.
Yeah.
And so, you know, early on I got to know a lot of investors as a result of being out here and, you know, networking, which is something that I just do naturally and get to know a lot of folks. And so I just said, hey, the investors want deals and these guys need help getting access to investors. Let's start making some introductions and make some connections. So I started putting people on that list, and more people asked to be put on the list, and the list grew and grew and grew and grew.
And it was all goodwill.
Nothing. No carry, nothing.
You were spending hours a week sending this email out, meeting entrepreneurs, and you would send it out to investors, do their job for them of Deal Flow, and get nothing out of it except the warmth in your heart that you helped fellow founders.
You know, I kind of looked at it more like I believe in the pay it forward in Silicon Valley.
Sure.
You really never know who's going to be the next Mark Zuckerberg. I mean, like, you meet some kid and he has no idea what he's doing, and then 5 years later, he's a billionaire. I've seen it over and over and over again.
It is pretty crazy.
Yeah, it's crazy. So, why not help people out early? And then when they become rich and powerful and famous and useful, they can help you out when the time comes.
Right.
So I try to do that as much as possible. And so, you know, with the deal flow emails, it was very much about like, you know, if they get funded, the entrepreneur owes me a favor and so does the investor. And I added some value. And more than anything else, I was just like, I was proud of the deals that I got done. I was able to look at those and be like, I helped do that. That felt like I was doing something important. And I learned a lot, which is...
Right. Did you ever do advisor shares or become advisors to companies? Talk about that a bit because there's a lot of people who are broke, but who aspire to be an investor. And you were kind of in that same situation,
I take it.
And you did exactly what I did in my early years, which was traded my network and knowledge for advisor shares. Talk about advisor agreements and how that technically goes down.
I mean, it's relatively straightforward. I would meet companies. You know, I was an early advisor to HelloSign, early advisor to Branch Metrics.
Wow.
Early advisor to companies that have done very, very well. And, you know, basically it was the same thing. It was like, hey, I can help you out. I'd love to be useful. And if you think I'm useful enough to give me some skin in the game, what I always say is like, you know, if you sell, I want to be happy with you, not sad that I didn't get a piece of the upside.
Right.
Let me be part of that journey with you and let me get to celebrate at the end.
Yeah. Seems reasonable.
Yeah. And then, you know, I always say, you know, like, give me whatever amount of equity you think is real, put me on the same vesting schedule that you're on and fire me whenever you want. And, you know, I've never been fired as an advisor. But, you know, one day that match will happen.
What would an advisor get in a startup company that's 5 or 10 people just starting out in year one or year two?
You know, it really depends on what you're good for. I mean, if you're just there to get on the phone once a quarter, not very much. If you're going to be on the phone twice a week, you get a lot more.
Right.
But usually it's
range.
You know, usually it's on the low end. It can be as small as 0.01%, so BIP, which is nothing. It can be as high as a percentage point if you're really engaged. And then there was one company that I basically helped co-found. It was my idea, and I got a bigger chunk. But I acted as an advisor going forward.
And you vest monthly over 4 years, just like the founders. They can fire at any time.
Whatever the founders.
So that lowers the risk on their part. If they feel that for the first 2 years you provided value, great. But they could say, you know what? We'll give you the first 25 bips, but not the second 25 bips, and you would feel okay with that as long as they talk to you about it.
You fire me whenever you want. If I'm not doing my job, then you know I'm not useful. Get rid of me. Look, for me, it's all about basically the journey for them, and if I'm not helping on that journey, then there's their job to fire me. Like, you know, one thing I think is really important to do as an entrepreneur is to cut your fat. You got to constantly be looking for stuff that's there because oftentimes the fat doesn't know it's fat and you can tell it, hey, look, you're not doing your job. And it steps up and it starts working a lot harder. And if it doesn't, then you should definitely get rid of it. So,
right. You know, when you have an underperforming individual in your organization at a startup, you just can't have dead weight.
You have to tell them that.
Team.
More than that, you need to tell them that, and there needs to be an axe that's there ready to clean the dead wood from the organization.
Right.
And everyone's got to know that it's going to happen if people don't step up because it's too easy to just let people just slide, and it's too easy to just slide. And that's a hard part about being an entrepreneur, but it's important to be done.
Yeah, cutting people, and sometimes they're your friends. Sometimes you have a big sentimental attachment to them because they co-founded the company with you, but at a certain point, the company continues to grow if you're doing it right, and sometimes the company outgrows the individual.
Yes, absolutely.
The individual doesn't keep up.
Yes, that absolutely happens all the time.
And it's something that first-time founders are generally not good at.
I think we're all bad at basically telling people who we care about, who we trusted, who we have loyalty towards that they're doing a shitty job.
Right.
Like, it's hard to do that.
First-time
founders, I think, generally struggle more with that or they have to adjust to that.
Mm.
But it's like every other skill of a first-time founder. It's, you know, I like to say that the startup game is a rocket ship into the walls of your incompetence. Mm. And so when you first start, your incompetence walls are very low and you hit them. But you look at Elon, I mean, he, you know, both Tesla and SpaceX, they hit his walls of incompetence and they were a lot higher than most of us would have gotten to in the beginning, but we all hit
it. Both of those companies almost went out of business multiple times. People forget.
Yes.
But there was a time when Tesla had 2 or 3 rockets blow up in a row.
Yes.
And there was a time, SpaceX had 2 or 3 rockets blow up. And there was a time when Tesla just didn't deliver the cars on time. And
yes,
they had challenges in production, even when it was just a short run car.
We all hit those walls and they're brutal and you got to kind of like scrape yourself off of them and rebuild your stuff and keep going.
Okay. Now the exciting part is you wound up starting a syndicate. Mm-hmm. And doing small investments. with AngelList, and you still have your syndicate there at angel.co/ Zach Coelius, which is spelled Coelius.
Yep.
Slash syndicate. Or you can just type in Zach Coelius and you'll find it. Over 1.9 million in backing now on your syndicate, which means in practicality, you'll fill up a 200K round.
So the biggest deal I've done so far is about a million. And my average check size now on the syndicate is running around 350, 400.
Wow. Yeah. That's pretty significant. That means if you have 99 slots or so, on average, 3,000 or 4,000 per person.
So it doesn't usually work out like that because I often like to have a minimum of 1,000 because I invest 1,000 in each deal because I'm tremendously illiquid, i.e. I'm broke.
Right.
A lot of equity and not a lot of cash.
Right.
And so it's not fair to me that other people can't invest the same thing that I invest.
So you're putting in $1,000 of
personally,
your own money.
That's all I got.
Right. That's the definition of a broke angel.
Broke as can be.
Yes. And so you put 1,000 in and then 200 or 300 comes in behind you.
Or more.
Or more sometimes. Yeah. And so people are betting on your ability to pick. And how many deals have you done on AngelList so far? How many syndicates have you done? Seems like you're doing one a month.
I think I'm 16 or 17 syndicate deals now.
Wow.
I think I've crossed 7 or 8 million via the syndicates, I think.
Wow.
I got to go back and like do the math, but I think it's like 7.5,
which is amazing when you think about it. As a syndicate lead, you get 20% carry, 5% goes to AngelList, you get 15. So it's the equivalent of you investing about $1 million or $1.5 million in these companies. It's great leverage, but you have to do all this work to source the deal, to do some level of due diligence, and then to syndicate it, and then on an ongoing basis support the founder. So let's go through and unpack each of those steps. How do you find deals today?
So all of my deals come from my network. People I know, you know, I'm lucky that I have, you know, I think 5,000 or 6,000 LinkedIn connections of people who I have good relationships with. Most of them are Silicon Valley folks. I think I have 110,000, 120,000 LinkedIn followers who, you know, people on LinkedIn who've, you know, for whatever reason think I'm useful and like to read my stuff. They send, all those people send me deals. We run a dinner once a month. We get 45 CEOs and founders together and have dinner and drink great wine, and which is awesome. And I network like it's my job, which it is my job, but I actually like it, enjoy it. And that all just means deal flow. I mean, there's more deals hit my email box every day than I could ever possibly filter through, which
is great. You've built up this reputation. In the early days, you didn't have as much deal flow, but over the last 5 years, now it's just a matter of sorting. So in the beginning, it was sourcing.
Yes.
And now it's tipped over into sorting.
Yeah. You build this business is all about reputation. You know, I think one of the things I have going for me that I'm really lucky is I really truly love the entrepreneurial journey. And so like when I meet with a founder, whether it's one of the companies I've invested in or a company that I'm just talking to, I get joy out of that process of figuring out how to make their business better, bigger, smarter, faster. Like I enjoy that. I love that.
And that enthusiasm, I think, is part of your reputation, is that you're enthusiastic. And for a founder, I find founders, it's a very lonely job.
Yeah.
So to have an enthusiastic cheerleader like yourself or myself involved, it means a lot to the founders, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this job is brutal. I like to say it's sort of like being in a dark alley with Mike Tyson.
Yeah.
And in one hand, he has an ice cream cone, and the other hand, he has his left. And you never know which one's going to hit you in the mouth in any given minute.
And you get a nice, cool, crisp bite of that vanilla.
Oh, it's so good.
Or you could get socked in the face.
Big customer calls you up. I love your product. Great. We love you. And you're like, oh my God, we're going to be rich. This is going to work. 10 minutes later, that big customer calls you up. Oh shit. I'm sorry. I thought you were another company. You guys actually suck. I mean, I've had that happen to me. Like in any given day, you can get.
When did it tip over for you? How many years of hustling as an angel did it take before the deals started chasing you as opposed to you chasing the deals?
So now, like I, like you said,
gradual process, but when did you feel like that shift had happened? What year as an angel?
Like I said, I was doing this for years before I actually became an investor. Mm. And then I became basically a full-time investor about 3 years ago. And I think it took about a year and a half, 2 years into the process before it started like feeling like there was real momentum there. Cruise really helped. Like being an investor in Cruise and having that giant exit, you know, billion-dollar exit to GM, everyone's suddenly like, oh, Zach knows what he's doing. It's not clear I know what I'm doing, but people believe that I know what I'm doing. And suddenly a lot of deals started coming my way as a result of that.
So having a hit and having your name associated with a hit, that is transformative.
Hugely, yeah.
And once you get that $1 billion exit, that's your first unicorn.
Yeah.
And that really takes the edge off, because now you have your unicorn, you know, on your belt, and it just makes you like, okay, you're kind of like being a made man in the mafia sense.
Yeah, I don't know about
that. It's like getting your button.
I don't know about that. I think it lends some credibility. I don't know if the credibility deserved, but people believe that I know what I'm doing, which has helped a lot.
Well, and you seem humble about that. There is something about being an angel investor, and maybe you could expand on this, that you really get the sense that there is a certain amount of randomness to this, but you also want to deploy strategies to get better.
Yeah.
So take me through some of your strategies in this randomness where we all have imposter syndrome. Oh my God, am I good at being an angel investor? Am I picking good companies? Because all of these companies are going out of business. The mortality rate is crazy, right?
Sure.
So what are the techniques you've started to develop? What can you share with us about being a better angel? How have you become a better angel over the last couple of years?
One of the bars that I think has worked relatively well for me is I basically, because I do a lot of work with my companies, I'm like, do I want to work with these people? Do I want to do this work? And that's led me to really, and I think hard about that, that's led me to really be much more careful about the companies I choose to work with and the people I choose to work with. And that's, I've been lucky, you know, so far none of the companies that I've invested in have gone out of business, and they're generally doing very well. And I think part of that is that, like, I've just been very careful to pick companies that I want to work for, then that's worked out well in terms of their outcomes. I tend to be a very contrarian investor, and I think one of the things I find is, I'll give you an example. So we were an early investor in a company called Entropy, and it was PhD computer vision guys out of NYU or Columbia, I don't remember, but they're super smart PhDs, and they built a little sort of technology that uses commodity electronic microscopes, $50 devices that connect to your cell phones, and then you can put that on a physical object like a Gucci handbag, and they can tell you in a couple seconds if it's a real Gucci handbag or not. Ah. Because at the microscopic level, it's very difficult to counterfeit the fabrics and all of the sort of parts of those handbags. And so then they have this giant database of images of real Gucci handbags or Louis Vuitton handbags, and then they have this AI machine learning behind it to basically take the image and quickly say, this is real, this is not real. But in the beginning, it was brutal. I mean, they basically were literally scanning these handbags by hand. You had these PhDs sitting there with handbags, sitting there like just going through, making the images of the real handbags. And then they had these little pawn shops who were, you know, big transactors in these handbags who wanted to ascertain if they were buying a real handbag before they bought them, before they flipped them, who were licensing these devices from Entropy. And it was slow, brutal progress.
So they would literally take a picture of the handbag and say, should I buy this in the aftermarket? Is it real or not?
Exactly. Well, the device is a microscope, so it's a little, basically like a microscope. Water cup. You stick it on there, and it basically, it takes a microscopic image, and then that feeds up to the database to see if that's a real Gucci handbag or not.
So they tell you just take 10 different pieces of it. Do the handbag, do the zipper, do this.
Exactly.
And then eventually they figure it out. Unless, of course, it was built in the same factory, and they were just throwing off the back.
Yeah, I mean, the technology is now 98.9% accurate. I mean, it's better than human beings.
What I love about that idea is that it puts the control in the hands of the people in the secondary market,
exactly,
who normally are being blamed for this.
Exactly.
And they get to say, listen, don't blame us.
Yes.
Which is exactly, it's like YouTube's signatures, where it's like YouTube is like, by the way, this is an episode of Game of Thrones, HBO, just so you know, proactively, there were 18 different dragon video clips uploaded today. What would you like to do with them?
Yep.
Claim them
yep.
and get the money from them, or take yep. them down, or do nothing?
Exactly.
It's very, very fascinating. Okay, but so
I was going to add to that story, which is like, they spent 2 years with no money and nothing, just scraping by. Mm. But the thing for me that like got me to want to invest in that is from the very beginning when I saw that entrepreneur, I was like, this guy is going to do the work. He's going to go through the jungles. He's going to go through the swamps.
How do you know from meeting somebody, what signaling do you get? Is it a sixth sense, or are there things you specifically look for to say, this person is dogged and will not quit?
I mean, so I used to run a business at the Olympics when I was a kid. And the secret to the Olympics business was you had to basically just run around to find out where the money was going to be made. And the secret to that is you got to have no shame And you got to be willing to basically work half the day. Didn't matter which half the day you worked, but you got to work half the day, i.e., you know, 12 hours a day minimum.
Right.
And you had to have no ego about who you were. You just had to figure out how to make it work. And as long as you did that, you just printed money. And if you didn't do that, you would lose every single Olympics. And so entrepreneurs are the same way. Like the guy who basically just will do whatever it takes, whenever it takes it, and has no ego about their personality or themselves, and no ego in their personality it doesn't matter what hotel they stay in, doesn't matter how they get to wherever they got to go. They're just really, really down to earth, humble people. Those are the people I like to work with.
The humble hustlers, the gritty humble hustlers.
Exactly.
And there's a part of you that likes to work with them probably because that's what worked for you as a founder. You were always a gritty, I'm going to get it done come hell or high water.
Yeah.
I remember always admiring that about you. What stage do you like to invest in? Where do you think you have made the best impact, had the best returns in terms of entry point? Do you like to invest before the product's launched, after the product's launched, in the Series A, when a lot of the issues have been de-risked? Where does Zach like to come in? What's your ideal Goldilocks zone? Not too hot, not too cold.
I've been learning this as I've been going, and it's really come to me that the place I like to find is that first market validation, that first point of a technology that you put in the hands of a customer and a customer gets excited about it. And I love Michael Seibel's sort of description of product market fit, which is like the guy that you're selling the product to, his hair is literally on fire, burning, like fire, shooting up, flame shooting from the guy's hair. You can hand him a brick, and he'll give you $20 for that brick to put out his hair on fire.
He'll smack himself
in the head with the brick to put that hair on fire. He'll pay you for that brick. It could be the worst product in the world, but it needs it immediately. It's like that pain is so significant. I like to say that your customers, you should be able to cold call your customers on their cell phone at 9 o'clock at night when they're putting their kids to bed, and they're like, hey, shut up, kid, I got to talk to this guy. You want to have their product problem to be so bad that you can give them garbage, but
they would just...
Throw
their money at you.
And so I really look for that. That to me is my sweet spot. It's really seeing that first bit of validation, that first bit of a product basically working and the customer having need. I don't love investing in founders with just ideas. I just there's too many of those. And I know with Triggit, we pivoted 7 times at Triggit, and 6 of those were stupid ideas, and all of them were mine. So I just think it's really easy to have dumb ideas. So I really look for that moment where I'll tell you another story in a second. I love that moment where the idea really starts to take off. Mm. Like, for instance, at Triggit, one of the things that we found is that in those first 6 pivots, we would call up customers and be like, hey, you should work with us. We have amazing technology. Come on, we're really cool. And they would say, no, don't call me back. And then we started working with Facebook, and we were able to offer retargeting on Facebook. And me and my sales guys used to have races for who could get to contract first on the first call with a client. So you schedule a 30-minute call with a client, and 2.5 minutes in, the customer would be like, okay, shut up, send me a contract. Literally minutes into the phone call, we had Best Buy, Home Depot, Walmart, TripAdvisor, Vistaprint, Mercado Libre, NetShoes.
So you know that moment.
It was amazing. That is the magic of this business,
right?
Is finding that sense of product market fit, and everybody wants to work with you. And I like to be that first guy to see it. That first little whiff of smoke coming off of the fire, that first glimmer, I like to be the guy that's like, oh, that's it. And that's where I like to play.
That's
the
interesting
fun part.
It's like right when you start to hit oil. It's like, ooh, there's something coming out of that. It could be a geyser. Let's find out.
Exactly.
As I tell people, that moment for founders is like being thrown into a gymnasium, like literally a huge gymnasium, and there's a light switch. And you know it's at 4 feet up. So now you have to walk around the entire gymnasium and find the light switch.
In
the dark. Which you're going to bang your head, you're going to trip and fall. But when you do find that light switch, all is revealed.
Yes.
And it's so obvious.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
And you're like, oh, there's the whole gym. I totally get it.
It's so easy.
It's so easy. But before you find the light switch, you're just wandering in the dark.
With wolves chasing you.
Right. With literally Mike Tyson swinging in the gymnasium when a crocodile in there. You could get to the crocodile of Mike Tyson before you hit the switch. What else is important to you? And let's talk about some deal breakers.
Sure.
So we know where you like to enter. Okay, great. The product's got some validation, but it's not 1,000 customers or 10,000. It's 1, 2, 10. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. Something in that range. It's just starting to be a flick or even one.
Yeah.
Great. What are the things that when you see founders it disqualifies them. I'm not talking about behavioral traits necessarily, but I would include those. But just this business is not right for Zach's syndicate and for you, because you said earlier, you have this test of, do I want to work with them?
Yeah.
So if a person's too difficult or arrogant or sharp-elbowed, does that mean you don't want to work with them or you want to work with them more? What are the signs that you don't want to work with a person?
Yeah. So it's tricky, right? I think there's both sides of the equation. You want a founder who is just strong enough in their conviction that they can bash through walls. Like to the job of a founder is to bash through walls, to be punched in the face over and over again and keep advancing, to fight through the really hard, difficult. I mean, it's the hardest job in the world. That job is really difficult. But at the same time, you want a founder who can step back from that. And in order to get through a wall, you have to be really focused. Like, you become a spear. Your whole mind, body, your being becomes a spear to basically get through walls. There's no other way to do it. You can't be kind of looking around being like, oh, I don't know if I should do it. You have to be very focused to get through walls. But you want a founder that can also take a step back and think and have a little bit of context and be aware that that wall that's in front of them, if they just take two steps to the side, they can walk around that wall. So they need to be dumb enough to bash their head through walls, but smart enough to know that not every wall is something that they should bash through. They need to be good listeners. That's critically important. And it's not just listening to me. It's listening to their customers. It's listening to their employees. It's listening to the market. Like, if you're not a good listener, you're going to get in big trouble really fast. Mm. They need to be humble. Like, for me, I really look for humble entrepreneurs, because I find that those are the ones that do the best job of really understanding the situation that they're in. Mm-hmm. Because oftentimes, you know, I trigger one of the problems. We were one of the first companies to get into the real-time bidding space. When there was 20 million impressions a day globally going through RTB, we were like first. And I was like, oh, we're first. And, you know, now there's 200 billion a day. I mean, we went from 20 million to 200 billion. Like, we recognized this giant market before anyone else did. And I was like, oh, we were first. So we should just go grab the biggest piece of the pie. We're going to win, because we were first and we're best. Stupidest thing I ever could have done. I really should have been like, where's the defensible part of this business? Where can I find a moat? Where can I like establish my little outpost and slowly grow it? And eventually I can go grab a big piece of the pie, but like, where can I survive?
Right.
And you know, it's, you know, if you're an arrogant entrepreneur and you just like shoot for the gold ring, but you're not ready for that gold ring,
right,
you're gonna fail every time.
Yeah, so there's some balancing act there of humility, but also indefatigable enthusiasm to, you know, run into walls and knock them down or go around them or just be clever. All right, when we get back, valuations. What is your typical valuation of a company you invest in? What is the range? Is there a point where it's just too big for a syndicate? What's your window? We know your window in terms of what stage the company's at, ideally, but what's the window valuation-wise today in Silicon Valley? Last couple of deals you did, what was the range?
So my range is pretty broad, because I have a couple different vehicles. Mm. So I have an early stage fund for small checks. I have the syndicate. The syndicate's written checks anywhere from $5 million to $500 million in terms of valuation. Huh. And I now have a multi-billion dollar fund that's an LP that writes checks in my name into later stage deals. So I'm kind of a weirdo when it comes to that question.
Tell me about that. What is this later stage? Jim, is that an AngelList thing, or are you doing another?
It's separate from AngelList. I went to one of these LPs, sort of an informational meeting, just sort of like, here's my portfolio, what do you think?
Yeah.
Just having a conversation.
A limited partner.
And there was a situation where HelloSign, a company I've been an advisor to for a long time, they rolled out this super awesome new product called HelloWorks, which I was really, really bullish about. And they very thinly capitalized, because they were profitable for years. We'd only raised a couple $1 million early on. And I was like, you guys need more capital. Here's a term sheet. Here's a $3 million term sheet. I'm going to go round up the capital. Let's get some more money into this thing. It was just a note. It was, you know, really designed to be a lightweight way to put a little more capital on the books so they could take off with HelloWorks. And one of the investors in HelloSign was also an LP at Founder Group. Huh. And so Brad Feld called me up and was like, hey, we just saw this deal. Do you mind if we do it? And I was like, look, I'm an advisor. Whatever's best for the company. If the company wants to do it, go for it.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, my little $3 million round turned into a $16 million round.
Wow.
So now I was sitting on this allocation with a Foundry-led round and good terms. And I this LP was like, hey, we like that. We'll take that. So we put together an SPV, and they funded that chunk. So I ended up co-leading that round with Foundry, which was great. I love
HelloSign. Amazing. So now you're able to put $3 million into a deal, get carry on that with other people's money, and you're acting like a venture capitalist in that case.
Yeah.
Or more, a little more like a proper VC.
Yeah, effectively, yeah.
Yeah. All right. When we get back from this quick break, I want to talk to you and do the portfolio review, where we go into specific companies, how you found them, what you think of them, how you made your decision, how they're doing, when we get back on Angel, the podcast. Ah, yes, Audible. I love Audible because it makes me smarter, and Audible is, of course, the leading provider of audiobooks and spoken word audio products. Their content is unmatched in the world. Their selection of audiobooks is tremendous, and you can access those books anywhere. Yes, that's right. iPhones, iPad, Android, Windows, your desktop, wherever you are, you can get your Audible. And the app has tons of great features. One of the great features that people may or may not know about is that you can very easily put it on sleep mode. So when I go to sleep at night, I put my AirBuds in, Apple's AirBuds, I put them in. My wife wants complete quiet, so she's sleeping. I like to go to bed, 30 minutes of an audiobook. I set the timer for 30 minutes, and I drift off to sleep while learning, and it just calms me down when I'm at the end of the night. I love doing that sleep feature. Also, you can speed up. Some authors speak very slowly, and I want them to speak a little bit faster. So I put it at 1.5 so I can consume my content faster. These are some of the great features. The other one I love is when you're listening to an audiobook, you can take a note. Additionally, when you're listening to audiobooks, they now have a killer feature, which is there's a little car icon. I'm looking at it right now, and I just noticed it in the app. And I don't know if they've talked about it, but they have car mode, where you click on the car icon, and it gives you a nice, big, easy rewind 30 seconds. You ever have that moment where you're like, that person said something brilliant in this audiobook? Well, with Audible, you just hit that one big, huge 30-second rewind button, and you get to reinforce that learning. And if you were daydreaming and missed it, you can just go boop. And a lot of times, I'll hear something interesting. I said, let me just go back and hear that one more time so I get it. And then you can hit a plus, a bookmark. And what I'll do is, if I'm in a situation where I want to take a note, I hit Siri, I hit the audio text, audio to text, and I write my note. So I just speak my note, save it into the app. It pauses the book while I'm writing the note, then I save it. Or I can hit play and take notes while I'm listening to the book in the Audible app. It also keeps your place. So if you're using your iPad or your iPhone or your desktop, it'll keep that synced. Chapter navigation is super easy. Speed control, we talked about. You can even share a book from your library by using Send This Book. They also have channels. This is a new thing that's been around for just a little bit, where they have exclusive content, original short stories, comedy, best of news, podcasts, all that kind of stuff. And if you don't like a book, you can easily return it, get an exchange, no questions asked. They have this listener guarantee, which, you know, I haven't taken advantage of because books are so affordable that I have even thought, you know, I don't even want to return it because I want the author, even though I didn't finish it and care for it, I want them to get a little bit of cheddar out of it. But maybe I should. Maybe I should do that. I'm just thinking about it right now. So here's our special offer just for our audience. Get a free audiobook at audible.com/angelbook. Audible.com/angelbook. You'll get a 30-day free trial membership. And my book of the week, I'm looking at two different books that I listened to recently. One is The Inevitable by Kevin Kelly, who was just on This Week in Startups, and he is tremendous, and the book is great. It's an amazing framework for how to think about the future of technology and where the opportunities are. But another book that I've seen all over the place is The Subtle Art of Not Giving an F, UCK. And this book by Mark Manson, I don't know who this person is, but it's a pretty interesting book because it does drift into some Tim Ferriss territory, some entrepreneur territory, but it really explains how you can craft a life without all this anxiety that people have. So it's kind of a hodgepodge of different ideas, but I actually didn't think I was going to like it, and I actually turned out I did like The Subtle Art of Not Giving an F. It's a pretty charged title, but I think the book is actually pretty good. I think you're going to get some good things out of it. So those are my two choices, The Subtle Art of Not Giving an F and Kevin Kelly's The Inevitable. That being said, I just downloaded Anti-Fragile by Nassim Nicholas Taleb. I can't remember how to pronounce his name, but he's the person who wrote Black Swan. Somebody who read my book, Angel, told me I need to read his book, Anti-Fragile, because it has a lot to do with my betting and gambling strategies. So If you haven't listened to Angel, my book, that's another recommendation. Go ahead and buy that. I actually speak the audio on that book, and we have some great episodes of Angel the podcast at the end of that where I do some original content. So thanks again to my friends at Audible. Go to audible.com/angelbook and get your 30-day free trial membership. audible.com/angelbook, audible.com/angelbook. I love you, Audible. Thank you so much for sponsoring independent media like Angel the podcast and This Week in Startups, which you guys and gals over there have been supporting for so long. I truly appreciate it. And congratulations on just keep iterating on the product. Every time I open that app, I find new features I love to go along with the great content library I've built over the years. So thank you again to my friends at Audible for all the support. Let's get back to this amazing episode. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Angel, the podcast. You can visit angelpodcast.com. Well, you can search for Angel, the podcast on iTunes, and hopefully you'll find it, and in other places where great podcasts are found. This is a new podcast. We've been syndicating it to the This Week in Startups RSS feed. So if you're listening to this on the This Week in Startups RSS feed, you can also subscribe, independent of This Week in Startups, to angelpodcast.com and get just these episodes. And in the future, we'll probably bifurcate and have these episodes just on the Angel podcast. So if you don't want to miss them, go to angelpodcast.com and search for Angel Podcast in iTunes, and hopefully we'll be on Spotify and all the other SoundClouds and YouTubes of the world shortly. So my guest today, Zach Coelius, and you can Google him or you can follow him on the Twitter, Zach Coelius, C-O-E-L-I-U-S, Coelius, got it. And Zach, this is the time where we go through your portfolio. AngelList, the greatest exit in the history of AngelList is Cruise.
Yep.
Your deal.
Yep.
So explain to us how you wind up, and Cruise got bought, I believe, by GM or somebody who?
Yep.
GM for $1 billion or
yep.
so.
Yep.
How did you find that company? How did you wind up investing in it?
Yep.
Let's start there.
Yeah, so I had known the CEO, Kyle, from, he was one of the founders of Justin TV, and I was very close with that whole crew early on. And when Justin TV basically, this is a great storied Silicon Valley event, but Justin TV, the founders realized Justin TV was not going where they wanted it to go. Mm-hmm. They all sat down, and I wasn't at this meeting, but I heard about it. They all decided, hey, let's go all do our own things, and let's split up the team and like go out and conquer new worlds. And amazingly, Michael Seibel, who now runs Y Combinator, went off and started SocialCam, which sold to Autodesk for 200, some really nice big number, million, 200 million, big number. Emmett went off and started Twitch, which sold to Amazon for $1 billion. So that was super amazing. Kyle started Cruise, and then Justin started Exec, and he's now has like a whole bunch of other startups. So he's off doing great stuff.
Justin and Kyle. He's very active on the Snapchat for the kids. Hey, Snaps, it's Justin.
He's very active.
Justin is hilarious.
I love Justin.
I like Justin Kahn.
So I didn't have my syndicate when the seed happened, one of the many awesome seeds that I didn't have capital for that I missed out on. When the A came around, I tried to hire Kyle for years. I love Kyle. He's super smart. And I begged and begged and begged to be able to invest and was lucky enough to be able to get a small slug that we put up on AngelList. It was gone in minutes. And
so you put in a couple of $100K or something?
A hundred. It's one of the smallest AngelList deals I've done.
Wow.
Yeah.
And then how many months later till the exit?
Not much. 9 months, maybe.
9 months, and yeah. It was 10 or 20x or something in that range.
Yeah, and it was amazing. Kyle had actually been over for dinner like the week before, sitting in my house. We were maybe a couple bottles of wine in, and like he was getting ready to leave, and he was like, "Hey, just to let you know, we got something fun coming next week. I think you'll like it." And I remember being like, "Oh, it's like a new product or whatever. Cool, that's fun. All right."
Yeah.
And he left, didn't say a word. And I woke up one morning, one of my backers sent me a note. He's like, "Hey, what just happened with Cruise?" And I was like, "I don't know." Groggily Google News Cruise and saw the announcements. I think I must have levitated out of that bed. I mean, it was amazing. I mean,
yeah,
absolutely amazing.
And those folks in the syndicate were able to get what is the best return yet for a syndicate. Syndicates are very early. They're under 3 years old.
Yeah.
But this is amongst the, or if not the number one return.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, amazing. I mean, to be able to invest and see that kind of return in less than a year is, I mean, pretty awesome.
And this is, I think, one of the things that should give people confidence, I think, in the syndicate process, which is, hey, if one out of 10 go 10x or 20x or whatever it is, you can start to see, like, hey, there is a possibility here that in investing in these companies could be a very worthwhile pursuit for a larger number of people.
Sure.
And when syndicates came out, it was people derided them. VCs were deriding them, saying, why would you want to do that? And now I think founders love doing the syndicate. Why do founders love doing syndicates so much?
So I think there's a couple of advantages. One is that you get the syndicate leads who oftentimes don't have a fund, who are doing it out of love, who are doing it, are willing to work harder, be there more. They're not, you know, some stuck-up rich kid with a fund who's just going to give you capital and then just give you a heartache from here on out. But who
it's
are
hustlers.
Yeah, people who are working Gil hard Pacino, to be able to
you,
be part
me.
Of the deal.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that really matters. Like,
so the leads are hustlers.
They work hard. Two, you get a bunch of, the people who invest in AngelList have proven to be really, really useful for my companies.
Yeah.
You know, they're out there spreading the word, they're sending employees over, they're generally value added. Mm. But you get 100 of them, but you don't have to deal with them unless you want to. What I say is my backers, if they have anything they want from the company, they have to come through me first, mm-hmm. and I filter that. So they're never going to be a heartache for my company, but they're always going to be value add. And it's turned out to work pretty well.
And have you seen people who invest in the syndicate go on to, let's say if they invested just $1,000 or $5,000, go on in a follow-on round to put in a larger amount of money?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, that happens all the time. Absolutely. I think people, they come in, they start kind of gingerly and take their time, which is a great thing about AngelList. You can put $1,000 into a deal and suddenly you're
angel investor in Silicon Valley.
Yeah, you're in a company, and then you can learn and watch, and you can slowly grow your portfolio, and you can build up. Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about Branch. This is a great company.
Yep.
Is it called Branch Metrics or just Branch?
Everyone calls it Branch, but right. Branch Metrics is the full name.
Got it. So when did you find this company, and how much did you put in, and how are they doing?
Yeah, so one of my friends who is at Facebook, now runs, he's the PM for Facebook payments, mm-hmm. sent him over
the
to
product
me.
Product manager.
Yep, product manager for payments. He had been an investor and advisor to these guys, and they were pivoting out of building a mobile application for making photo books, which is simply you just upload your pictures to a mobile app and you could literally make a photo book and they would print and mail you a photo book. Wasn't working so well. But they had this problem where people would create the photo book and then they would send a link to their friends, be like, hey, check out my photo book. The person would click on that link, go to the app store, come out of the app store, and then they'd be like, what do I do now? Right. There was no ability to deep link through the app store. Right. So they built this technology to do that. And they came over and they're like, hey, what do you think about this technology? And I remember just getting really fired up, banging the table. This is awesome. Let's get this thing going. This is like, this really changes the world, because it's the thing that was really exciting to me is it's super strategic. Imagine the sort of the URL structure on the web. Imagine a company that owned everything after the .com for every website. So you go to Bloomberg.com, but then you go to any deep link below Bloomberg.com, and there's a company that intermediates that, a private company. I mean, that strategic position was so powerful. And I got really fired up about that.
Is this like the seed round or the Series A?
It was just four people, just an idea at this point.
So seed round, probably. Yeah.
So I became an advisor, introduced them to one of my good friends, Ben Narrison.
Yeah, Ben's awesome. He's going to be on the program.
Ben, that day, he met him that day, walked him into NEA that day, and NEA gave him a term sheet. Scott Sandell at NEA gave him a term sheet that day.
Wow.
$3 million investment, just because it was just so clear that this was going to be a really great company. And then the team was amazing, and it was just one of those obvious deals. And then the rocket took off. So it went from sort of a four-person company to now they're, over 100 people, and they just raised $60 million from Andy Rubin, who is the founder of Android. So, I mean, one of the smartest guys in mobile technologies just anteed up in a big way.
Playground Global.
Yep.
I guess is his incubator for doing these type of things. And that's going to give him all kinds of data.
Yeah, I mean,
the
Branch,
data they have must be insane.
It's amazing. I still continue to be shocked. Well, Google basically rolled out a competitor to Branch, and Branch roundly kicked their butt. I mean, whooped them. So I'm surprised Google didn't buy them a long time ago. But
Whatever. We talked a bit about entropy, which is E-N-T-R-U-P-Y.
Sure, yeah.
And it's that interesting. I have it pulled up on my screen. I'll just play the video here so people can see it. But, I mean, what an amazing idea. When you saw this, this seems to me like one of those ideas that VCs would never back. It takes an angel to say, you know what, this is so crazy and contrarian that this little tiny camera, and we can see the camera here for those of you watching the video, showing and verifying the pattern on the Chanel bag, it looks like, or who knows what kind of, maybe Gucci bag, a Louis Vuitton bag. There you go. Shows how much I know. And it gives the certificate.
Yep. Here's, insurance certificate. They will literally write you insurance that that is a real bag.
That is incredible. Yep. It's one of those things you see and you just go, wow, what a clever, amazing idea built off of
Computer vision,
AI. The cloud, AI, just all this stuff that's been building over years.
Yep.
Like that Microsoft and the hardware would have been just cost prohibitive,
impossible.
You know, 10 years ago,
impossible.
And the technology was just not there.
Yep.
And so that company's doing pretty well.
They just raised their A from Digital Garage and a bunch of other angels. We're just actually leading that syndicate on AngelList right now as we speak.
Oh, wow. Fantastic.
We're putting in $500,000 into that round. They just signed a global deal with eBay. So now their eBay is using them around the world to basically authenticate physical goods. And they have deals in place with marketplaces all over the world now. So they went from basically providing that to pawn shops in the middle of Kankakee, Illinois, to now they've got the biggest companies in the world signing deals with them to basically roll that technology out. And you know, counterfeiting is a $1 trillion market annually, $1 trillion in losses to brands and retailers and marketplaces. All these people are losing money because of counterfeiting. And this basically can now...
What does that device cost?
$50.
So yeah. If you're an eBay seller, they could require you to use that device on Louis Vuitton brands.
So they actually don't sell the device as hardware. It's actually a lease. Uh-huh. So you have to pay them actually a sizable amount of money to get access to it.
Right.
But because they it's a nice business. But yeah,
for verification.
I mean, basically, if you're selling a handbag on eBay in 12 months, if you don't have an Entropy sign of approval, I bet you your bag doesn't sell.
Yeah. And eBay could say, we're just not going to, for these brands, because they're getting sued by these brands constantly.
Exactly.
And they could just say, you know what? They could just throw their hands up and say, if you put it in the category Louis Vuitton, if you put it in the category Chanel, it requires this.
Yep.
And this certification is going to cost $25.
Yep.
Go to this store or they'll email you the unit. You can verify it and send it back, whatever. Or maybe you could bring the bag to you could email the bag to a third party who could house it and test it. That would be an incredible business.
There's a bunch of ways to do it. And I think and the great thing is it's not just handbags. They have a deal with one of the biggest shoe retailers in the world to do shoes. So like basically you can take in a pair of Air Jordans and they'll tell you if they're real or not. They've got, they're working on the next product, which I can't pre-announce, but there's a new product coming out. And basically every single product in the world that's not reflective, computer chips, pharmaceuticals, packaging, currencies, it doesn't matter.
Right.
Super awesome.
That'd be super great to know that this is not a fake Canadian dollar or pound or even an American. But there's already solutions for American money.
Yep.
Talk me through One Signal. That's another investment you made that seems to be doing pretty well.
We just raised the series. I think it's the series B. I always lose track. It's like B, A, C. It's so confusing. But
right now in Silicon Valley, what was the Series A is typically called the seed, right? The $3 or $4 million round.
Yeah.
Series A's are how much now, typically?
You know, I'm always confused, but usually I think of the first money as sort of like the friends and family round of like sort of 200 to 500. And then there's, you know, a round of like $1 million to a couple million. And then there's
the big seed round.
Maybe, or maybe not.
Or a pre-seed or an angel round.
I don't know. I say we just get rid of all the vernacular and just use numbers.
Right.
Round one, round two, round three. But
right.
You know, whatever. But anyway, so they just raised a $7 million round from Signal Fire, which is a great VC firm doing really cool stuff. Signal Fire gave them a nice, and we just invested
in
that.
How did you meet this company?
So this one came to me through a guy you might know, Antonio Garcia Martinez.
Of course.
So he's an old friend of mine, and he was an advisor to the company. He was like, hey, you should talk to George. And I was like, sure.
He wrote the book?
Chaos Monkeys.
Yeah, he was on the program.
So I love Antonio. He's crazy, wonderful, brilliant.
He's a curmudgeon.
Yeah.
He's like anti-Silicon Valley, but soaking in it. I love that. He was breaking my chops. He's like, you just think angel, because of the book, and he was like, you think angel investors from like middle America and the Rust Belt should be investing in companies? I was like, I have to think about that. But if you lived in the Rust Belt and you were a coal miner, you made $75,000 a year or $50,000 a year going to the coal mines and you invested $500 or $1,000 and you were accredited, would I have a problem with that? I don't think I'd have a problem with that.
No, definitely not.
Yeah. I was like, I think you're kind of turning your nose up at individuals having the ability to do what they want with their money, because I know people are putting $1,000 on this Conor McGregor fight versus Floyd Mayweather or the Super Bowl. So if you can gamble on those things, why not gamble in startups? What's your advice for family members or non-accredited people who want to dip their toe into this? How do you advise them?
I mean, the easy way to think about this game is a positive expected value, positive EV lottery ticket. Right. So you're going to get your ticket and just expect that you're going to be ripping it up over and over and over again. So if you can't afford to lose the money, then don't do it.
Right.
Because you're going to lose the money. But in aggregate, if you invest in enough startups, hopefully, eventually, you get lucky,
right,
and you get the one that, you know, returns $1,000 or $10,000. It's the Uber,
Airbnb
or Dropbox, and you know, and so the math works in aggregate at scale, but it doesn't work on the individual deal by deal basis. So
right,
if you can't afford to lose the money, if you can't afford to put it into a lottery ticket, don't do it.
How many startups do you think you need to invest in at this early stage? Let's say pre-Series A. How many would you feel comfortable with your family member doing? How many would you advise them to do to have enough diversification that they could have a positive return, but not so much diversification that they're just indexing or spray and praying?
You know,
or do you think indexing is okay?
I don't have a problem with indexing.
Yeah.
I think indexing is fine. I think there's a lot of bad startups out there.
Right.
And, you know, if you can avoid those bad startups, you can go a long way to basically increasing your returns.
Got it.
I think basically if you invested in every startup that ever happened from the day one, you probably would lose money.
Right.
I don't think that's positive EV.
No.
So it's hard. I don't have a good answer for that yet.
Yeah.
This is a hard job. It's a hard business. It's not easy.
It's not easy.
Yeah.
And it's part of the reason why I wrote the book and started the podcast, was to start a dialogue about these best practices, because I thought what you said early on was really prescient, Zach, which is, am I any good at this? And how do I know if I'm good at it when the majority of hands you lose?
Yeah.
But on the ones you win, hopefully you win more than you lost in aggregate. I put the number in my estimation that if you can get to 30 or so companies,
yeah,
I start to feel like, you know, there'll be a positive outcome after 10 or 20. That seems reasonable to me to being enough. But I also think the big cardinal mistake that a lot of young, new neophyte angel investors make is they invest too much money in the first couple of deals.
Sure.
And they pick the deals that people like us and Gil and Cyan and other professional people have passed on.
Yeah.
In other words, if that deal is going to you as a neophyte investor,
there's probably something wrong.
And they can't clear market with anybody else.
Probably something wrong.
Probably a reason.
It's true for me. Like when a VC sends me a deal, I almost always basically say no, because the VCs only send me the deals that they're not going to fund themselves.
Right.
And they can't get anyone else to fund. They just want my dumb money to fund that deal. That hasn't happened as much. They show me a little more respect. But when I first started doing it, man,
they're like, here's something to distract you. It was interesting when I worked in, there's a way to screw your competitors, and the VCs look at angels sometimes collaboratively, but sometimes they do look at them as competition, especially the syndicate ones who can take 5 or 10% of a round, or 5% 10% of a company now.
Sure, yeah.
If you're putting $500K in, it's a $6 or $7 million valuation, all of a sudden you got 7, 8, 9, 10% on the cap table. They do look at you differently, don't they?
Sure, yeah.
Sometimes positively, sometimes negatively.
Yep.
One of the ways you can really screw your competitors is by sending them the bad deal flow and hoping they engage it.
Yeah.
It's like sending your friend, it's like sending your frenemy. Like, I remember we had this pizza guy at this restaurant I worked at, and he was insane. And he literally caused chaos in the restaurant. And literally, a competitor tried to hire him. And the person who owned the restaurant said, you know what? He's incredible. It's going to be a huge loss for us, but I totally understand if he wants to live closer to home or whatever. Whatever the reason was, he was about to fire him.
Yeah.
But instead, he found this other job, and he was like, his kid's incredible. And I was like, didn't you just say that he was the worst employee you've ever had in the history of 30 years in the restaurant business? He's like, absolutely. This person's a complete disaster. He'll sink any culture or any company he's involved with. I'm like, but you just told him the opposite. He's like, Yeah, I did. I was like, oh, wow, that is so gangster.
That's awesome.
Yeah. SkySafe. Let's go through this in the portfolio here. Safely take control of reckless or malicious drones.
So this is a great
this story. Sounds completely science fiction. What are we dealing with here?
So this one came to me through Kyle at Cruise. Basically, he was like, this guy, the founder, is great. Love him. One of the smartest guys I know. Go talk to him. And I met with him at the Palace Hotel, actually, in that great atrium at the Palace Hotel.
Sure.
And it was one of those situations where I fell in love immediately. I was like, I want to do this deal. And he was like, I've talked to 25 VCs and got 25 no's. And I was like, oh, I don't care. I'm going to help you get this round raised. Like,
wow.
But this is because it's the thing that's really scary is how easy it would be to use a drone to crash an airplane. Or like, you put a pound of explosives on a drone and you fly it up in the flight path of an airplane that's landing in an airport, and like that plane's going to crash. Like, it would be trivial to crash a plane with a drone. And so they really need this defense.
You could just throw a drone into...
That's not enough. The engine's not a problem. The engine will just chew up that drone, no big deal. But a pound of explosives on a drone is more than enough. Just pound.
I wonder if they're taking drones and throwing them into Rolls-Royce engines to test that thesis.
Sure, yeah.
So
The engine would get chewed up, but the plane can still glide to a landing. That's not
right,
a problem.
Right, it'll have one engine.
Yeah.
So the real problem with drones is somebody puts explosives on them, and then it goes into the...
It hits the wing, really. I mean, it could just...
Yeah, if it goes into the engine and it blows up, then there's no wing.
The engine. There's a lot of things. So it's basically drones, airplanes, bad. A lot of other ways the drones could be really scary. Big, big asymmetric risk there. So I was like, we got to do this company. I got to be part of this. I'm done.
But so basically, if a drone comes into airspace that's not supposed to be in...
So what this company does is it uses proprietary software to hack the drones at the radio controller level and crash them or take them over. So if...
Wow.
Super cool. So this is a great story. Basically, I was like, I'm going to give you $500,000. I'm going to find the money. I'm going to raise a round. Let's get this done. A week later, he calls me up. He's like, I got good news and bad news. The good news is Chris Dixon just gave us the term sheet. Chris Dixon's over at Andreessen. Bad news is now there's only room for you to put in 150. And I was like, yay. Oh. So super happy because he got this great round from this great investor. Super sad because suddenly I went from being able to make a sizable investment to like a little tiny one.
So Andreessen Horowitz pushed you out.
They squeezed me out, and I got cut down to size a little bit. You know, big VCs they have a little bit of weight they can throw around.
Did you say to them like, hey, this isn't fair? I want to get 350. Did you push back, or did you just say, you know what? I'll save my fight for another time.
Yeah, first of all, like, I don't believe in basically me getting into a squabble with another investor when it's the entrepreneur's company. Like,
right.
That's not my job, is not to basically get in the way of the entrepreneur doing his job or her
right.
job. My job is to help them.
Right.
And a squabble between me and another investor does not help the situation.
Right.
Like, so, you know, so in that case, there's no way that I would ever basically cause a problem for that round. I will, you know, I would say to the entrepreneur, I'd love to put in more. If you can let me put in more, I'd love to put in more. But if you can't let me put in more, because at the end of the day, the decision is the entrepreneur's.
Yeah.
If the entrepreneur wants me to have in more, they say to Andreessen, no, we want Zach in for more.
Yeah.
And he, in this case, he was so excited to get that round done, he didn't want to mess with it, and
see,
he wanted to
take
it.
This is the sharp elbows of some of the VC firms,
sure.
where they do this kind of stuff. See, there's a little slight difference between me and you, because I would have been like, you know what? If you do this to me, Chris, and I don't get my slice, that I'm not passing you the ball anymore.
Sure.
I'd be like, because that's the kind of guy I am. I'd be like Chris Paul coming down the court. I'd be like, you know what? There's three other players on the team. I'm freezing you out. The next deal I do, I'm not passing to you. Because I think that's a little hostile on their point, because you found the company, you validated it, you earned that 500K slot. I think these guys are jerks sometimes for doing that. I think
happens.
It's short-sighted.
It
you
happens.
Can't say it, but I will. I say it's a jerky move.
That's okay. But anyway, so they... They just signed a deal with the DoD to roll this out around the world. And Andreessen just basically preempted the Series B and let it, or Series A, I think it was the Series A.
Series A, it says here they put in $11.5 million.
$11 million went in. I got a bigger slice this time, which I'm
good.
Happy about.
Yum, yum. Yum, yum for Zach.
Yeah, and company's going great.
Did you join the boards? Why don't you join the board?
I don't join the board for two reasons. One is that I have 30-something companies now. If I was on the board of all those companies, it would be very difficult. Two, it's hard for me to really be the entrepreneur sounding board and be able to like talk to them about the hard decisions they have to make if I'm on the board,
right.
because then I'm their boss. And that really, if you, the board, you have to manage your board and what you tell them very carefully.
Yeah.
And you can't really just tell them the truth. You have to tell them, you got to make sure their highs aren't too high and their lows aren't too low. And you got to manage the reality of the fact that they can freak out a little bit. And I didn't want to be in that position.
It's interesting when you're the CEO, the board can freak out.
Yeah.
And the employees can freak out. So it puts the CEO in this odd position of, well, if I tell the unvarnished truth to the board, they might think this is chaos.
Yeah.
and I'm not qualified to run the company trying to replace me, if I tell the unvarnished truth to the team, they're going to be like, why did I leave Google or Facebook for this? I need to go back to safety. This is my paper that you're messing with. I need to, you know. So this is what the role of angels are, I find, is to be honest and have that candid dialogue.
Exactly. So yeah, so I've not taken any board seats.
Interesting.
But yeah, so the company's doing great. I love those guys.
Hey, let me ask you a technical question about AngelList.
Sure.
Are you doing one of the funds on AngelList now?
I have one of the funds, yeah.
Great, because this is something that I think is a interesting innovation.
Yep.
Tell me about what AngelList funds are,
yep.
How you wound up doing one, what the process is. Because I left AngelList before all this existed because I made my own fund, but it seems like part of their learning has been when people like Jason leave and have their own funds, maybe we need to have funds, right? Like, I think I was like a little bit too, since I was one of the first syndicates, I had escape velocity, but I think this is kind of the plug for people leaving AngelList. Explain funds.
Yeah, I mean, so it's a committed pool of capital. It's basically a bank account. In my case, it's $1 million, and I can write checks off of that 25 to 100K, and I'm obligated to not put money in via syndicate or any other way into any company that has a valuation of less than 20 million unless I basically invest from the fund and max out my contribution from the fund. So basically all my early stage deals are getting a 25 to 100K check from that fund. And so what it does for the backers is they get one, they don't pay deal by deal carry, so they get diversification. So there'll probably be about maybe a dozen companies or more in that fund. There's a bunch in there right now and they're doing great. And I think it's really, really good. It enables me to write smaller checks. So the syndicate process is relatively cumbersome. It's hard to get into some hot deals oftentimes when you have to like go through a syndicate process. Syndicate process, because there's 8K in fees, doesn't work unless you invest at least a couple hundred thousand.
Right.
So in this case, I can put in a 25K check really easily and quickly.
There's one fee to set it up.
Yeah, just one fee.
So it's essentially that $1 million is like one SPV.
Yep.
And you then don't have to worry about hitting the 250 number to pay for the 8K and setup fees of the SPV. The 8K is on $1 million, so it's de minimis.
No problem. So, yeah.
Interesting.
And it works well. It works really well. And it gives me another tool in the toolbox,
right,
which is like when there are deals that where the syndicate's not the right fit, I can use the fund.
So would you do a syndicate deal without doing the fund? No, you have to.
I can't. If it's over 20 million, I can. So I have a syndicate right coming up relatively soon. They just announced today Art19, which is an amazing podcast company. I've been an advisor there for many years, and they had raised a little bit of capital, and they just raised $7.5 million from Bertelsmann and Dow Capital. And so I have a piece of that. And so I'll be syndicating that, but I won't be doing it out of the fund because the valuation is too high.
Yeah.
But company's doing great, and I'm super excited about them. So yeah, there are instances where I won't use the fund, but high valuation functionally.
Yeah, it's interesting because I had three or four people email me and say that on AngelList, they're directing new angels to funds. So if you're a new angel and you haven't done investing yet, they're saying you have to do a fund.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so I had three or four people who were like, I tried to join your syndicate or another syndicate, and they said I have to join a fund. So I think they're letting the old angels who have experience do syndicates. But if you're a new angel coming onto the platform, because people forwarded me the email, because I say in the book, this is the best place to start, is go to AngelList or Seed Invest. And they said, they're not letting me join syndicates. They're steering us towards funds.
I don't agree with that. I think
I kind of like it for a new person because think about it, they get 10 investments and they learn.
Sure.
But I guess maybe it's their adults.
I think the thing that's the magic to AngelList is there's always been a way to get exposure to this asset class via passive vehicles. Yeah. But you know, if you think about like the equity markets, the vast majority of capital in the equity markets is people who are picking. Whether they're professional pickers or amateur pickers, they're people who are picking. They're expressing a thesis. And I think the great thing that AngelList has done is it's enabled people to pick and express a thesis and have ideas in this asset class. Mm-hmm. And being able to go in and put in $1,000 into a little startup and learn from that process, I think is a really, really special thing you can't get anywhere else. And I think AngelList needs to embrace that more. And I think sometimes they kind of like, they're like, oh, it's better if they're in the fund. And I'm like, maybe better, but it may not be better. I like the ability of letting people pick.
I kind of feel that way too. But I think part of it is because it's such a high risk category,
sure,
people are trying to protect people from having a bad experience.
Sure.
And I think it's interesting to me because there have been no actual lawsuits over syndicates yet. And that was the big thesis early on when the VCs were deriding it.
Yeah.
A lot of VCs were deriding what we were experimenting with syndicates, and they said, you're going to wind up getting sued. The company's going to wind up getting sued. When one of these things fails, and it's like,
yeah.
Well, I think they made a big list of disclaimers. Don't do this if you can't afford to lose it. Here's the time horizon. Here's diversification.
Yep.
And AngelList did a really good job of explaining this to people investing.
Yeah.
And they're accredited investors. Yep. So they're the top 5% of the world. Like, how could they not get it, right?
Yeah.
It's very interesting to me that they're so focused on making sure that there isn't a bad experience when I think anybody who's coming into it should know that this is the riskiest asset class. I mean, it might even be riskier than cryptocurrency. I don't know. Who knows?
It's as risky as I could possibly imagine.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. But the reward is, God, you could hit 1,000x or a 500x or a 200x. Where does that exist in the public markets? It doesn't.
It doesn't
exist in bonds.
This is the only investment, I think, that has the ability to functionally change your lifestyle. Like, you can go in from being a relatively rich person and come out of this being super rich.
Yeah.
And there's not many other investments that, you know, have the ability to change your life. You may get a little bit richer or a little bit poorer, but your life's not going to change.
Right.
You're not going to go from coach to flying in private jets,
right?
In any other asset class.
From your words to God's ears. Finishing up, we've seen two trends: one, foreign money.
Yep.
Two, non-accredited investors being able to do these Title III and other Reg D. I don't know what all the terms are,
sure.
But these what Republic Seed Invest are doing.
Sure.
What are your and we can't get carry on those.
Sure.
But what are your thoughts, broadly speaking, about non-accredited investors putting $250 or $500 into a Republic or Seed Invest kind of vehicle, which is very new? They're under a year old. What are your thoughts on that?
I'm not an expert there.
There's
pluses and minuses, but I don't know enough to venture off a firm opinion there.
Yeah, I would tell people be very careful.
Yes.
Because it does feel like the deal flow on some of the equity crowdfunding sites is the deal flow that didn't.
Yes, much lower quality.
It might be in some cases lower quality. In other cases,
it is.
Some people are doing side by side. So that was an interesting thing. I saw a couple of companies that I was going to invest in do side by sides where they took accredited and non-accredited. Because Seed Invest does both. So they'll do a side by side, which is like, let's say they raise $500,000 from accredited investors and $200,000 from non-accredited. That to me feels like the future. But the Republic is former AngelList folks who are only doing equity crowdfunding, and then AngelList isn't dipping down into this. They gave it over to Republic, I think.
I honestly don't know enough to say.
It's interesting. It's just like the whole world is changing, and it's very interesting to see a person like you who was doing great as an entrepreneur jump into this. And then make it your full-time career. This is now your full-time career.
Full-time job.
But you get recruited by a lot of venture firms. Why wouldn't you take the easy money and be a later stage and not have to do this crazy blocking and tackling, grinding it out? Why don't you take a job at a top-tier VC firm, which I'm assuming is available to you?
Sure, yeah.
Like a team player.
Yeah. One, it's going really well. The dumb luck is hitting me in the head like I would never have believed. I mean,
Right. Basically
almost every company I've invested in has marked up in the last couple of years. And so it's like when I'm getting lucky, you know, when you're playing poker and you're running good, you don't step away from the table.
No, you just
keep going.
Because everybody at the table is like, my God, that person is running like a god. Stay out of his way.
We like to say when the deck is hitting you in the head, just let it keep hitting you in the head. And so that's been really good to me. And two, I'm just loving it. I'm having so much fun doing this.
Like,
I don't know why would I go do anything else?
It's interesting you say that. I was trying to explain this to somebody, like, why wouldn't you just go work at a top tier VC firm? And I was like, I'm kind of a solo act and I like making my own decisions. I think angel investing works best when you have someone like yourself or Cyan or Gil or myself or Esther Dyson just making independent critical decisions without talking to people.
Yeah.
Because once you start to talk to people at this early stage, it's like,
talked about everything.
How on earth is Cruise going to compete with Otto, with Waymo, Uber, Tesla, GM? Well, it's like, it seems farcical that somebody would be able to who made Justin TV. Like, the Justin TV team's going to create their own self-driving car startup? Please.
Yeah.
Sounds ridiculous.
Sure.
A VC would never engage that conversation, whereas an angel's like, well, I know these people. They're smart. And this actually isn't that big of a jump. If you know how to do streaming video and doing computer vision, these are not that different.
I mean, if you think about like the best hedge funds in the world, they're not run by committees. I mean, you think about most of the best sort of asset managers. I mean, Warren Buffett is not a committee. He's got a partner who's a sounding board, but it's not a committee.
Yeah.
And so I actually think there's something real there with like, you know, this asset class that being run by committees in the venture firms. Mm. I'm not sure that's the right answer. Right. I don't know enough yet. I'm only three years in.
They have the veto power. One person can kill a deal. And, you know, every firm has a story of that. There was one partner who killed the Google deal, one partner who killed the Facebook deal, whatever.
Yep.
And do you really want to put yourself in, when the upside is so huge, why would you put yourself into that basket?
Or the politics. I mean, yeah, the money gets made in this business on the outliers. It's the weirdo deals that all the money's been made in. Like, there's every single great company is... You know, we could point out to why it was a weirdo deal. I mean, yeah. Facebook was nothing compared to MySpace. Google was like search engine number whatever. 15, Airbnb was a crazy. Uber, I mean, I told Travis, I was like, look, buddy, I love you. This is great. This is awesome. I'm sure it's going to work, except for the taxi unions are going to crush you. There's no way Uber's going to work. Who would ever do this? Like,
right.
I mean, like all these great companies that have turned out to be amazing were weirdo deals.
Right.
And committees aren't very good at doing weirdo deals.
No.
So... You know, I'm not sure the committees are the right answer.
I agree with you 1,000%. I think once you start talking it, you're just going to talk yourself out of it. And like Uber was the easiest one to talk yourself out of.
Oh.
Airbnb. I was just talking to somebody. I was like, I asked the crowd, how many people here have stayed in Airbnb? And literally 80, 90% raised their hands. Then I said, how many people have hosted somebody at their house in an Airbnb? And 10% of the crowd. I said to myself, I would never stay in an Airbnb.
Really?
And I would never host an Airbnb because... At least not in the classic Airbnb where you stayed in the house with the person.
Yeah, but you're too rich now.
It doesn't matter for you anymore. No, I am kind of cheap. Actually, I'll get into that. But I just thought to myself, even 5, 6 years ago, I think you're going to get murdered by a serial killer or a bunch of meth heads are going to rent your place and trash it. In which case, a bunch of meth heads did trash your place.
One of many.
One a time. And it was a manageable issue. So I think if you look at the reasons of why these startups won't work, the list of why it will not work is, 100 to 1?
The Uber taught me a really important lesson, which was basically that when you have a really significant wall at the beginning of the company, in my case, I looked at the taxi unions and their control over local governments, and you see those big walls really early on, the obvious walls.
Yeah.
You got to look harder when you see that wall. And behind that wall, there's a crowd of people begging for that product to happen.
Right.
Who desperately need it to occur.
Sure.
Because if you can get through that wall, it's just clean running forever.
Open ocean.
And it's like you can build amazing businesses as a result.
That was Airbnb. If they could get through the hotel taxes and local governments and housing groups or whatever, the housing boards of individual condos or whatever.
Yep. Nope.
And they were rule breakers. All right, listen, we could talk forever. If you're starting out your angel career, I think perhaps one of the greatest first steps would be to back Zach on AngelList. He is considered, focused, and he does the work. So if you're listening to this podcast and you're thinking about being an angel investor, there's no better place to start than joining Zach's syndicate. You don't have to do every deal. You can pass.
Everything.
And you would learn and you just get to read the deal memo.
Sure, yeah.
And you can put in as little as $1,000 per deal.
Yep.
So it is the, and some people have gotten a little snooty putting $5K or $10K minimums, $25K minimums. Yeah. But you, like me, feel like it should be more open than that.
Yeah.
I did put a $10K deal minimum on a recent Cafe X one because there was so much demand.
Yeah.
But then like some people secretly were like, hey, can I get in for $5 or $3? And I was like, sure.
Yeah.
So I kind of like... I set it at 10, and then I let 2 or 3 people in who had done many deals, like over 10 deals in the syndicate, to do it. But Zach is the guy you want to back. He has done an amazing job, does the work, and the results speak for themselves. Nothing is guaranteed, but I can guarantee you that he'll do the work. And that is, I think, one of the most admirable things in this space is to do the work as an angel. And so I have a lot of mutual respect in what we do, but I really, it's great to have you on the podcast because you are the shining example of you can hustle your way into this. And I constantly get asked by young people, how do I become an angel if I'm not anointed by Sequoia like I was? Well, you were not anointed by Sequoia in the Scouts program. You hustled your way in doing 1K, 2K bets and being a broke angel and being an advisor to the point at which you now have a $1 million fund and you have LPs who want to let you do bigger things. I mean, it's amazing how this has come together if you just do the work.
Dumb luck is always your friend.
Yeah, see, this is the thing. Humble people always say it's luck. What I tell people is, I got lucky 8 times.
Well, maybe there's something for
you. How many times have you been lucky? Is it now five? What do you say, about five, six times you've been lucky in the last 5 years?
It's going really well. I can't complain.
You've done 16 investments, 17, something in that range?
Yeah.
And five or six of them have done very well?
More, I think.
Yeah. So half,
more,
10?
More. Yeah, they're...
Two out of three have done very well.
It's going really well. The deck's hitting me in the head. I'm going to enjoy it. I'm going to try not to.
Well, here's the thing is, I think you'll get better too. One of the things I've learned is like, as you start to get your signaling and you get your chutzpah and you get your confidence, what happens is, just like at a poker game when you're playing really well, you get confident enough that you're like, you know what? This isn't a situation where I can make a move. This is a situation where I can maybe steal a pot, or this is a situation where I can trap. And when you start to get the wins under your belt and your confidence builds, what it does is it becomes self-fulfilling prophecy. Once you have a cruise, or an Uber in my case, then people go, you know what? I'm assuming Zach's going to hit another cruise. Well, then you know what that means? That means founders assume that too. And they're like, well, if I get Zach, it gets me closer to being a $1 billion exit, right? Even though that's not causation, it is correlation. And once you start having unicorns in your portfolio, or you know, $100 million or $500 million companies, the new companies are going to think, I want to kind of hang out with that crew. I want to be affiliated with that crew. And so the way you can get affiliated with the crew that is winning is to go to angel.co/Zach Coelius, Coelius/syndicate, or just
Google
Zach Coelius, Coelius. Go ahead and check out angel.co and you'll see him there. Tons of disclaimers here about angel investing. It's high asset risk class. There are laws around it. Read my book, get a great attorney, go slow, be diversified, only invest a small amount of your net worth. There's a million different best practices we could give you, but the most important one is to just go slow, take your time if you're going to do it, and invest, what, low single-digit percentage of your net worth?
Just assume you're going to lose it all.
So assume you're going to lose it, and if you don't, be delighted.
Yep.
And what I always tell people is, if it's 1 to 10% of your net worth and you're an accredited investor, if you lose half of it or all of it, you're probably making it back in the stock market at 7% a year in returns, like, or whatever your day job is. So take your time, go slow, and enjoy the journey.
Yeah. It's a great journey. It's really fun. It's probably the funnest asset class there is. So
yeah,
can't complain about that.
Nothing like being able to say that you were an early investor in a unicorn. I mean, once you hit that cruise,
pretty awesome.
It's pretty great.
It's awesome.
The greatest feeling ever. It's sort of like winning for poker players like us. Zach and I both play poker. He's a great poker player. It's like getting your bracelet.
I
feel like you got your first bracelet.
I feel jingle jingle.
It's nice. It's a nice feeling, huh?
Yeah.
Get that bracelet ceremony going.
Let's get another one.
You got another one coming.
Let's get another one going.
Here we go, right here. See this here?
Yeah.
That's six bracelets.
Beautiful.
I'm gonna do a little Phil Hellmuth here.
Beautiful. I'm jealous.
A little Phil Hellmuth. The little six bracelets over here. I put three on each side just to balance them out, Zach. All right. Listen. The hit rate is the other thing that you have to look at. Is you've done almost eight times as many deals as you at this point. So I think your slow, methodical pace is going to pay off in a big way. I think you'll have less donuts than I will. But you know, you gotta keep making bets. And there's many different ways to be an angel investor, is what we've learned over time.
It's a great thing you learn how to do it. What works for you?
How many people are angel investing right now, do you think, like full time, like us? How many people do you think? 500? 1,000?
I don't know. Probably, maybe. I don't know.
Put it in the hundreds.
It's not a huge number.
It's not a huge number of people doing full-time.
Full-time, not a huge number.
There's probably low tens of thousands doing it recreationally on AngelList, right? Like if you have, when we left AngelList, I had 1,100. Now we're getting 20 people a day since I did the book. So we have about 1,500, 1,600 people.
Well, yeah.
So I think if we represent, you have 500 people in yours, 1,000?
About 1,000.
About 1,000, of which probably 20-30% have done a deal so far.
Yeah,
usually it's like a lot of gawkers.
Yeah,
but even still, if you start to think about that, well, maybe you and I represent 10% of the total pool or 5%. So if we were 5%, that means there's 20 times that. So it's probably 20,000-30,000 angel investors on AngelList, Seed Invest, Funders Club, I guess, is another one. All of those platforms together probably have 50,000 accredited investors. I'm going to guess.
I have no idea. A lot.
I think we're actually, you and I are probably 3%, 2 or 3% of the total pool are in our syndicates. Think about that, how much growth there's left.
Oh, we got this industry is just getting started.
I think so too.
First innings.
Yeah, I just think it's going to get to the point where there's going to be syndicates that have, you have 1.9 million, I have like five. Gil has like six or seven. like Kevin Rose had like five and Tim Ferriss had like five, and but they never did it. They stopped.
Yeah.
I think there's going to be a possibility of like syndicates having $5, $10, $15 million in backing.
Sure.
At which case, how far are we from a Series A happening, do you think?
Not far at all. I think within the next year or two,
we'll be writing a multi-$3, $4, $5 million
check off of the syndicate.
Wow. Which means each person in the syndicate has to do 30 or 40 thousand.
There's a lot of family offices and high net worth individuals and hedge funds that are starting to look at this as a way to express their thesis and to hedge in the asset class.
Interesting.
Which is like, if you're, let's say you're really long parking garages. So let's say you own parking garages. Well, autonomous cars are going to destroy that business. Absolutely crush it. I mean, if you own a parking garage, it's going to go to zero because there's no need for parking with autonomous cars.
No.
Well, you better go long autonomous cars to hedge out your risk. Go really long.
So just find the 20 companies on AngelList or wherever. And just invest in 10 of them or 15 if you can.
Yeah, and because if that sector takes off the way that I think it will, and it's got a long way to go to become a multi-trillion dollar sector, but I think it will be, you can make a lot of money if you invest in it now.
Yeah.
Hedge out because you're going to lose all your money in the parking garages, that's for sure.
Well, I think the parking garages are all going to turn into like really dope condos, like although they're kind of weird how they're...
Yeah, it'd be kind of funny.
They may have to be knocked down.
You gotta tear them down, yeah.
They're land. The land, yeah. That's interesting. You think about all these... I think actually when Apple built their new headquarters, I read this somewhere that a lot of the new garages are being built with the concept that they will not
be turned around. Yep.
They'll be turned into something else. So they're actually leveling them in a way that the ramps could be removed, but they would be office space essentially.
I think that's eventually. Happening. But relatively smart.
Super smart. All right, everybody. We'll see you next time on Angel the Podcast, angelpodcast.com. If you want to go to the website and sign up, give us your email. If you want to check out my syndicate, it's at jasonssyndicate.com. I suggest you become as many syndicates as you can sign up for, I would do, because absolutely, you get to read the deal memos. And reading the deal memos is such a great way to learn. And again, start slow. Start slow and get your legs under you like Zach did. All right, continued success, Zach, and some of your best deals. We'll see you all next time on Angel the Podcast.